It's always great when we have Triple R historical making person with us, Simon Knott. The architects were groundbreaking radio.
He actually makes history as well as being history.
Yeah. That's right.
Well, thank you. That's a great introduction. Good to be here. I don't know if I quite deserve that. But anyway, yes, there's lots of other people here who have made history at this station.
Absolutely. But you're one of them, Simon Knott.
Thank you.
And we're going to talk culture and specifically soft architecture and placement. Tell us about that.
Yeah, well, this is it's a sort of slightly nebulous term, this one, placemaking, and it means different things to different people, but I'll sort of try and, because in some ways it's actually a sort of pursuit, and there are placemaking consultants out there, the people that sort of work in this field, but I think in a wider sense it's actually a sort of change in the way that we understand architecture and urban design and the way we practice it, and really can come down to the sort of planning design, but also the ongoing, and I think this is a really important part of it, ongoing management of public space. And really, it's been around since the sort of 1970s or 1960s earlier, and talks about, I'll come back to this, but sort of things about place identity, how we engender space with meaning, and how we create communities. I think that would be the most important way to describe it. And really, it's a reaction against the sort of modernist planners of last century. And modernism came in and said, let's just go tabula rasa, we're going to just wipe everything out, and we're going to build these great new clean cities, it's modern man, you know, we're on the path to kind of, you know, a better place, and we don't need any of this kind of old stuff or this, you know, these slums, let's get rid of them all. And a very important text in the history of the world, I would say, a contend, is one by a woman named Jane Jacobs, a very important lady in New York, and it's called The Death and Life of Great American Cities from 1961. And she was a great advocate, she was an activist, in fact, who fought against these sort of slum clearances and saved places like Greenwich Village. I mean, that was going to be cleared out and sort of expressways put through and all this kind of modern infrastructure. And she said, actually, no, there's really good stuff here, and they protested and she was arrested and all this sort of stuff. And they fought to keep some of the fine-grained stuff of the city. And that really is kind of, you know, the things that start to... And it's not necessarily a heritage thing. It's actually just the sort of grittiness and sort of celebrate the kind of stuff that's not new that actually is part of the way that we understand space and the way that it gives us meaning.
So, I mean, I guess for someone like me, I'm thinking about space but what's how do we create spaces around things that perhaps are already sterile or not conducive to community?
It's a good question, and I think this is probably the sort of failing of a lot of the modernist architects, in they thought they could do everything, you know, where the architect is sort of God and everything's designed from sort of a kilometre up in the air. You do great plans like Canberra. Canberra's a great example where it's got these beautiful sort of drawn plans, and it kind of works at sort of that level, but actually the scale's all wrong and it's too big and you can't walk around, so it's all about cars. So what I think, you know, placemaking sort of recognises is, and I think I always use the example of Fed Square because I think it's a really good example of it, where the architecture's, I mean, I think, okay, people love it or hate it, that doesn't really matter. The space in the middle is kind of good and robust. It's not the best architectural space in the world, but it's managed better than any place in the world, and it's regularly in the top 10 public spaces in the world because of the way that it's managed. And that means, you know, the free Tai Chi classes at 7 o'clock in the morning, the homeless World Cup soccer, you know, protest marches there, you know, people jumping around on the big screen, you know, the camera, all that sort of stuff, and all the kind of sculpture things that go on there and events that happen there. And it's programmed 24 hours a day to make it like, so it's all the kind of, and that's sort of its soft infrastructure. It's the stuff that kind of gets that planned in to actually make those things happen. And really good placemaking will start to put little seeds into a place that then allow the community to kind of, you know, to join in and actually create the real, you know, the real meaning within that space and the idea of place. So it's a kind of start. It's the seeds that kind of make communities strong.
So what happened down at the Docklands then?
Well, it's a good question, because that is one of the examples, the opposite example of one of the failed attempts at sort of making place. And there's been a lot of discussion around that over the ensuing time about what went wrong there. And I think one of the biggest mistakes they made there was they... Unlike Melbourne, when Melbourne was planned and the land sales back at, you know, the 1830s, 40s, they just carved up little bits of land and gave them over in small parcels to a whole lot of different people. So it allowed the city to grow organically and lots of little things to happen. Whereas in Docklands, they gave over like 9 hectares to one developer and said, you do something here. So it was kind of destined to fail at that sort of, it's just too big, you know, and it doesn't have any of that small, fine-grained stuff. And I think really the sort of essence of placemaking is really, and a lot of these people, I've got a book here called by one of the pioneers in this kind of area is William White, called The Social Life of small urban spaces. And what he did was actually go and start, rather than sort of, I know all the answers, I'm going to plan this thing, is actually go out and look. He went out and he did, there's a great photo on the back of it with his camera out. He went and did all these studies of all these spaces and sort of said, what's wrong here? What do people need? What is the ways to make these? And it was making little benches for people to sit on and comfortable spaces. Scale's a really important thing. Greenery's a really important thing. So people don't like to sit out in big open windswept spaces. They feel quite uncomfortable. So, you know, they want to sit in kind of intimate spaces, maybe with a back to a wall, maybe with some greenery around them, in the shade, out of the wind. You know, that's who we are as sort of animals, is kind of what we need. So, you know, I think that kind of idea of comfort and safety, and I think there was a study that was just done in the States on 26 communities, and the three things that were most valued in making good spaces were social initiatives, so things that actually give some sort of social benefit within that in that space, aesthetics, and openness. And that was really, there's a sort of safety kind of thing that comes into that as well. And I think probably one of the, you know, Melbourne's very lucky in this respect, because another sort of pioneer in this is a guy named Jan Gehl from Copenhagen, from Denmark, who wrote a book in 1971 called, wonderfully titled, called Life Between Buildings. Ooh. And he looked at all the space between buildings. Before that, architects just designed these things. They don't worry, it's just the street. And Rob Adams from the City of Melbourne really took this on board, and this was the start of the kind of regeneration of Melbourne CBD. And I lived in the city back in the 90s, early 90s, and there was kind of nothing there. You know, at nighttime it was dead, there was sort of nothing there. And what he did was just change some policy stuff at the start. They just said, let's encourage residents in here, this postcode 3000 thing, make it really easy for people to have residential, you know, make houses in the city. So this had this influx of people coming into the city. And they did a great thing in De Grave Street, the start of the laneways movement, with a group called Village Well, who are one of these placemaking groups. They said, there's all these artists kind of around this space here, but none of them really kind of get together. They're sort of lacking a kind of sense of community. No one knows who they are. They're all sort of, you know, faceless in these buildings. So they just closed off Flinders Lane down near De Grave Street and had a party over a weekend. And suddenly all these people got together and they kind of realised they were all living there, started to kind of, you know, develop this sort of sense of community. And they put one good cafe operator into De Grave Street, and that was the kind of birth of the whole laneways movement. So it was just kind of showing people, you've got all this stuff here, like, just use it, and allowing people to, giving them permission to use it. And that, you know, really, you know, now 20 years later, it's got one of the most, you know, noticeable and kind of iconic parts of Melbourne is the laneways.
It's so certainly one of the markers, isn't it, of the livable cities around the world. But a lot of these places have kind of grown organically, so how does the architect approach not being like a little too clinical about that?
Yeah, it's an interesting one, and it's really important, because I think a lot of these people, you know, a lot of the kind of groups that talk about this maybe talk about incremental change, and it is very difficult. And I think, and sometimes I think Docklands gets a little bit unfairly criticised, although it's not great, and I agree with that, but it's only really 15, 20 years old, and I'm confident in, you know, in our lifetimes it will be one of the great places in Melbourne. It will happen. But yeah, you do need to sort of plant little things to change over time, and that will gradually has just shifted the way that the city started to, and that's, you know, it happens over years. It doesn't happen quickly,